So we try to be punctual tonight, not Nicaraguan time, neither Colombia or Cuban time, American time. Oh, yeah. Neither Brazilian time, because we are always late. Please rise. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bless you, Father, for this time of Lent. We bless you for your love. We bless you for your goodness to us. We ask you tonight, send us your Holy Spirit. Help us to discover a little bit the deepest meaning of Lent, of Easter, of our lives, also of your fatherhood. We ask you all this through Christ our Lord. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. So very good. I was asked to, can you hear well? Too much echo. Too much echo. What can we do? Don't use it. Then my voice is. This is better, but this is ugly. So very good. Extra mile. Can you hear me? Huh? I'll put here in Justin. You see how pro we are. So my the idea is normally I prepare something. This time I did not have much time to prepare, and I was asked to give a talk. And then I was very much touched by the gospel of the prodigal son. And I say, why we don't speak a little bit before speaking about, I'm going to speak about Easter. They say that this is a Lenten talk, but it's more Easter, because Easter is at the door. If you want to listen to Lent, the buzz is gone. Easter is at the door. So I'm going to give you a word about Easter, little word, announcement. But before that, I just want to speak to you just a little bit about the figure of the father. Now, speaking with the children and with the youth, we see how much suffering there is, because our father can be our hero or our villain. And it's a subject that is very touching, because it touches us. When we speak about other things we like, but when we speak about Father, it touches us. But I saw the need at least a little bit to speak a little bit, because we live, last time I spoke a little bit about the cultural world. There is a cultural world. There is an attack on Christianity, on values. There is a rebelliousness against moral teaching, against rules, against everything that we hold for solid. There is I have no agenda. Whatever comes, comes, okay? Bear with me. There is this guy, this Polish sociologist, his name is Zygmunt Bauman. Zygmunt Bauman. He wrote a book, fat book like that, that I study him, that the title of it is Liquid Society. He describes our society, our culture, as a liquid society. There are three volumes. A liquid society that produces a liquid life, that produce a liquid love, and we keep going, that produce also a liquid relationship. Our relationship more than ever has been very liquid. What is liquid? What is the first definition of liquidity? I don't know if that exists in English though. Is we can say the antagonist, is the contrary of what is solid, everything. And we live in a liquid society. Our culture is getting away from the solid culture of the Middle Age. And if you read Karl Marx, there is a certain in his writings, there is a certain moment that Karl Marx says one of the main goal of our goal is, he says in Italian, is, I translate to you so that is profanare il sacro e sciogliere il solido. Our main goal is to profane the sacred and to melt, to liquefy the solid. What is more sacred in society? What is more solid in society? The Christian faith, the family, marriage. This has been always the target of modernity, the target of it. Man has, if you see, I'm just giving a little introduction. If you see the French Revolution, was the public manifest that man has rejected God, especially as the Father. The philosopher used to speak now after the French Revolution. The French Revolution was, okay, when was the French Revolution? I would do like the kids today at school. Who knows when was the French Revolution? Sir, you there, you look very smart. 1789, that's correct. 1789. This was, if you want to put a date on post-modernity, this is the date that somehow it cuts with tradition, with the Middle Age. A new man was born. God, we don't need, they don't say God does not exist. They don't say that, because they are not crazy to say that. They say, let us live as if God does not exist. This is what we call in philosophy, in theology, practical atheism. What is a practical atheism? God exists, but our life is not conditioned by his existence. And on the contrary, there is this guy, I wrote a thesis on Romano Guardini. Romano Guardini, the name is Italian, but he was in Germany. He was a German guy. His parents was Italian, but he was German. He was a teacher in the University of Berlin. He helped to form a lot of people. He was so famous, Romano Guardini. He was so popular, especially among the youth, because after the First World War, people lost their hope. People was because the fruits of the French Revolution, the fruits, what we call fruits, was the dust of the First World War and the Second World War. This is the madness. When man wants to live without God, he produces monstrosity. When reason is inclined to itself, God, the famous philosopher God, used to say that the reason, the dreams of reason can produce monsters. When there is no God, because in the French Revolution, God disappears and reason takes place. The truth disappears. Freedom takes place, an absolute concept of freedom. But when freedom is not rooted into the truth, freedom becomes a weapon, becomes a slavery. And basically the First World War and the Second World War, these are the results of a society that has rejected God. And Romano Guardini, he dedicated his life a little bit to rebuild the soul of the youth, to rebuild a whole generation. And he was so popular. I speak about Romano Guardini because he's nobody ever heard about him. Pope Benedict, yes, if you read Pope Benedict, he quotes a lot. He's like a father of the church of modernity. But somehow, nobody teach these guys in the seminary. I don't know why. The guy is a monster in a good sense. He's a warrior. He wrote so many books. He helped so many people. He creates a cathedral in Berlin called Weltanschauung. Weltanschauung is the vision of the world. And he was so popular that Hitler removed him from his cathedral. And I wrote a thesis on him. The title of my thesis was Virtue and Education on Romano Guardini. And one of the chapters was dedicated, the title was The Drama of the Modern Man. The drama. And what is the drama of the modern man? Do you understand this question? El drama, you say drama in English. So, what is the drama, the anguish of the modern man? He answers in two ways. The first way, the first drama of man is not about modernity. It's the drama of men of every age. It's the drama of men of history that we call original sin. One of the common ideas in the French Revolution, all the philosophers, Karl Marx, Freud, Nietzsche, Rousseau, Hegel, Kant, Descartes, Gramsci, and many others, all of them, they have one point in common. For them, there is not original sin. The explanation, the cosmology, is another cosmology. They have removed the teaching of the church of original sin. And when you remove the original sin, then man, Guardini say very nicely, then man is in a place without place. He's a writer, but he's a poet. He's speaking a very nice way. Un sitio senza sitio. The modern man find himself in a place without place. It seems that he's lost. We have lost our patria, he say, our country. Because this word, patria, comes from the father. Patria, patrius, is the fatherland. The fatherland. When I was making parentheses, when I was studying Italian, it was a very beautiful phrase that I memorized, that was this lady used to say every time when she would start teaching Italian, she would say the same thing. She would say, ogni patria è casa mia perché da ogni patria posso vedere il cielo. Every country is my country because from every country I can see heaven. This was a beautiful definition. Every country is my country. But modernity has lost this vision. The modern man is in a place without a place. He does not know how to answer the big questions of life. What is the meaning of life? Where I came from? Where I'm going? Why I suffer? Why I live in a beautiful house? I have a nice bank account. I have everything that they say that I will be happy. All titles, I collect all titles. But there is something that somehow I don't know how to explain. No, because man lives in a place without place. And this drama, part of this drama, Romano Guardini, I'm going to base a little bit on him. Romano Guardini said that this is the drama of every man, that is original sin. Original sin, was a separation from God, was a rupture. He says that was a rebelliousness. Man rebels against God because man wants to be God. And this rebelliousness produced a rupture. Original sin produced inside of us a rupture, a spiritual rupture, an emotional rupture, a psychological rupture. It's a deep, man is broken from within. This is the solid teaching of the church. Man is broken, not totally corrupted. Luther, Martin Luther, would say that man is totally corrupted. The church say no. Man is broken, is wounded, but not totally corrupted. Not totally. There is a seed of good in man. It's very nice when in the time of Advent and Christmas, there is this song, there is this reading that of John the Baptist regarding to the prophet Isaiah, that he say, when the Messiah come, he will not blow the light that is finished. He will not break la cana que ya está rota. I don't know how to say that in English. The sugar cane. When do you have a sugar? Have you seen a sugar cane? Hello? Thank you. Sugar cane. The reading say, when the sugar cane is broken, it's good for nothing. You just burn it. But the reading say, when the Messiah come, he will not destroy the broken sugar cane. It's very nice. Meaning that even though it's broken, there is a little attachment. It's not totally broken. There is a seed of hope in man. There is a, you know, the Greek, I'm going too much where I should not go. But anyways, you know, the Greek, they have this mythology, they say, about the Pandora's box was this forbidden box that nobody could touch. But obviously, who opens? A woman. Curiosity is the virtue of the woman. It's not even a sin, it's almost a virtue. As mulheres são curiosas por natureza. And she went there and said, do not open it. But she could not hold. She went to see what is in this freaking box. And then when she opened, all the evil of the world came out. Fear, violence, every kind of evil. This is the Greek way of the Greek version of original sin. But then it says that even in the Greek mythology, it says that the only thing that remained was hope. Hope. There is something in us, very deep in us, even when things is so bad, but there is always something else that wants to believe that things can get better. Why? Because we carry in us the echo of paradise. We carry in us the echo of the relationship with the Father. We carry in us. We may reject it, but we carry it. And many cannot deny that. So this is the first root of this drama of modernity. The second, Romano Guardini says that the modern man, the drama of the modern man is that by denying the Son, by rejecting the Son, automatically we have rejected the Father and we have killed the Father. And then he used a character, Krivox, from the book of the demons of Dostoevsky. Do you want to read good books? Dostoevsky, he is very good. Have you heard about the guy? Dostoevsky. He's a Russian philosopher and writer. He wrote books that is classics, such as The Brother Karamazov, Crime and Punishment, The Idiot, the excellent book, The Idiot, I read it. And one of his books, Dostoevsky, in a very nice way, he says that there is a man, that he says that it's not only necessary to eliminate the Father, But the existence of God is the reason for our anguish. To know there is a God, man lives under an anguish, under fear. The idea that there is a God makes man somehow not developed, make him less than what he is. It's totally the opposite of the revelation. And he says that for man to become himself, he has to eliminate God. He has to kill God, kill his own father. He killed his own father. But what? Where relies the drama of man? That the same guy in his book that say that we have to eliminate the father is the same guy that in the book that say he says that deep down what he desires is to be embraced by his father. And this is the drama that we have. In a spiritual sense and in a human sense, part of the drama, part of modernity, that man has rejected God. At the same time, man will like to be embraced by his father. Something very similar happens with us. We live in a society, this liquid society that is talking about. One of the main targets of this society is to destroy the image of the father. It's a clear target. Fatherhood is in crisis. There is an attack on the authority, on masculinity, on the father. And we see this everywhere. Tell me, for example, what's the last movie that you watch where there is a family, there is a father? Men on the movies, men is always picture. They are recording me, right? So I have to be very... He asked, Father, could you record you? Because some people want to see. One of these days I'm going to get in trouble. But the movies, when you watch a movie, the figure of the father is always somehow covered. A man, the majority of the nice men on the movie sometimes, they are not, they have their tendons. And the macho man is like a uga uga. They have muscles, but they don't have brain. They are not sensitive. The most sensitive ones are those that do not like women. More or less, they play this role on the movies. And it messed up our minds. It's very difficult. When you see a father, when you see an image of a father with a children in the beginning of the movie, you can wait for tragedy. This will last 5 minutes, somebody's going to get killed, and that's it. Because there is this agenda. All the movie that we see is catastrophic, is the end of the world. The last movie I watched, Remnants, also Miami was flood. There is a philosophical statement behind movies. They are saying that life is an absurd. Jean-Paul Sartre was a philosopher in the 60s. He was the husband of Simone de Beauvoir, the famous feminist. He says that life is an absurd. That if you take life serious, an act of virtue will be to kill yourself. Jean-Paul Sartre. The existentialism, something terrible that they teach at the university to the kids. But anyways, let us go back here. Then this is part of the drama, of the modern drama, that man has, there is this division. And I was touched by the gospel of 2 weeks ago, because this is exactly what is in the gospel of the prodigal son. This man, Father, give me half of my inheritance. The child only asks the inheritance when the father is dead. In his heart, the father was already dead. And he went to a faraway country. St. Augustine says that any place away from the father's house is a faraway country. You can be here, But if you're not in the Father's house, if you're not in relation with the Father, any place is a faraway country. And this man, he goes to a faraway country, and he goes so low, so low, so low, that he finds himself among the pigs. Not even worthy to eat. How low can we go, dear brothers and sisters? How low? Man is the only animal that can go against his nature. We can act like angels and we can act like demons. It depends. It depends. And then when he's in the bottom, when he's there, not even worthy to eat the food of the pigs, he remembers that he has a father. He remembers, I shall go back to my father's house. This is very much connected with the drama of man. We escape the father, but what deep down, men will like to be embraced by the Father. And this is what, and so many, so in our days that we live in a society that the fatherhood is in crisis. It's not so much the prodigal son. The point now is the prodigal fathers. So many prodigal fathers. So many children we like to go back to the father's house. But there is not a father. There is not a father waiting. And if we don't find our true father, then we suffer a lot. But that's why Christianity reveals us as father. So to help us on that, the seminary, I come from a Redentoris Mater seminary. I was ordained in Guam. I come from a Redentoris Mater seminary. It's a seminary for the new evangelization, where vocations for the neo-catechumenal way is born, and then we go to this kind of seminary. I was 3 years in Brasilia, 3 years in Washington, D.C., and then my last years was in Guam, and now I'm here. So some of my friends from the Redentoris Mater of Boston, we have 9 Redentoris Mater in the U.S. They did a beautiful video on from fatherless to fatherhood. And I would like to share with you. I think you will like it. It's a very nice, it's 10 minutes or less. And I think just to continue, then I conclude, because it's a very nice video that speaks exactly about that. Now, before you play, can we switch off the lights? Because it's too much light, right? Maybe somebody could help you. Stay here, stay here. Who can switch off the light? Angelica, obviously. Angelica. And then if time allows, I also at the end, if God allows me, I would like to say one little word on this world in Ukraine, in Russia. A vision of faith, a vision of faith. But first let us speak a little bit of fatherhood. So it's very nice how he presents it. Oh. That was like, hello, I'm coming.
like it? Then you can say. That is my intention, the first part to show you this video and to finish saying this 1 minute, just to say this is what Easter is about. Easter is also comes to help us to discover God as our Father. This is what we celebrate Easter. Easter is the greatest feast. I like what he says, St. Paul, one of his letters, he shouts, be reconciled with God if we are Father. Be reconciled. Because of our rebelliousness, we could not be reconciled. Jesus Christ, to prove that God loves us, has to incarnate, has to become man, has to enter into the cross. And from the cross, he says, Father, forgive them. So he has to enter on Easter. Easter is the greatest feast, the Easter Vigil. I invite you to experience the Easter Vigil. It's amazing. When you go to the book of Exodus, it says in the book of Exodus, tonight is forbidden for you to sleep because the Easter starts on the history of Israel. I heard the suffering of my people. And then God says, Moses, go and tell the Pharaoh, let my people go, let my people go. And the Pharaoh has a hardened heart. And then God has to send the plagues. And then finally he says, you shall kill a lamb, and you put blood on the post head, on the post of the doors. And the angel of death will cross the whole Egypt. But on the house where there is the blood, the angel will pass over. This is the first meaning of Passover. And God break the barrier. He opened the Red Sea and make his people pass dry feet. Somehow, God there already showed the paternity of God. He said that nothing is impossible. Maybe the resentment that we have with our father or somebody else, it can be like the Red Sea. Israel was in a very difficult situation. In front of him, they have the sea. Behind him, Pharaoh and the chariots. Was a catch 22. Was no solution. Oh, God exists, or they are gone. But God opened the Red Sea. Does this miracle, and the people pass. This is the Passover. The people not even have time to bake the bread. That's why they brought unleavened bread. And they celebrate every year with the unleavened bread and with the cup, the wine. The cup is the sign of the victory of the promised land. And Jesus Christ says, this is no longer the bread of slavery. Now this is my body. This is the cup of the promised land. And what is the promised land, brothers? The promised land is to find God as our Father. Jesus Christ says, the kingdom of heaven is in you. It's in you. But for that, we need a walk. We need a time of gestation. And that's why, and that is very, in another day we can speak more about that because it's a fascinating the gospel. But to discover God as our Father, Jesus Christ says, if you don't hate your mother, if you don't hate your father, you cannot be my disciple. To find God as a father is necessary also to hate our father. Not in the way that we used to hate the idea that we have, the how our life should be. And to discover that through this father, through this mother, God has given us life. And through this life that God has given me, I can have eternal life. And this is why Jesus Christ came. This is baptism. Baptism is like this Red Sea, where we were away from God. And through baptism, God, Jesus, called us to be children of God. And through Easter, entering to death and destroy death forever, the risen Lord also gave us the Holy Spirit. And only a person that has the Holy Spirit, says the the scripture can call God Father, a Father that loves us. A Christian is someone that sees the love of Father in their history. A Father that even in the tragedies of our life, He was behind us. Santa Teresa, and I finish with this, Santa Teresa of Lisieux, she used this very nice image that God is like a father that holds the child by the hand in a dark night, and suddenly the child doesn't feel the hand of the father, doesn't see the father, only many hours later, and then the child is mad. They say, "You have abandoned me. You have forgotten me. You allow me to go to this dark night without you." And the father doesn't say anything. The father accepts the rebelliousness of the child, like the prodigal son. The father accepts. But one day, when this child grows, when she starts understanding, when she have a little faith, and then somebody tells her, "But you don't know the whole story. You don't know the whole picture. The whole picture is that in that night it was a big stone in a mountain, and this stone will fall, and on the way when you're passing will crush you and many other people, and something terrible would happen. Your father seen the future, seen the past, he went before you, ahead of you, to make sure that we go to the way, and he removed this stone." This is image that Santa Teresa used to say that many times in our life, we think that we are alone, we think that we are abandoned, but our life is like a mosaic with precious pearl, and some of these stones, sometimes they look dark, but the darkness of our history is to resplendent the light, the beautiful icon that God is doing for us. And this icon has been completed through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's why in the gospel, this man goes back to the Father. And he says, "Father, give me the inheritance." What is our inheritance? Our inheritance is the Father. This is our inheritance. La nostra herencia è nostro padre. God is the inheritance. He is the Father. And if he is my Father, then I can forgive my father on earth, poor guy. So this was a little bit my intention tonight, to meditate a little bit on the figure of the fatherhood, but also above all, to see that all of us, we desire to find a father. Even the Greeks, I love Greek mythology. This was the whole point of the Odyssey. The Ulysses wants to go back, and Telemachus wants to find his father, because there is a need to see the eyes, the face of my father. That's why Jesus Christ comes, and Philip says, "Show me the father, show me the father." Because this is a need that we have in us. And then Jesus Christ says, "But Philip, I am with you for so long and you have not recognized me. Who sees me sees the Father." And this is the great mystery of Christianity, that Christ has revealed to us a Father that loves us, a Father that loves you. This is what I always say to the kids. God loves you. He will never abandon you. He's always there. So courage, brothers. Time is already almost night, so I hope that you got something out of it, and I think I am done. There is not like a punchline, just that's it. Tonight just is the end. So please rise, let us pray. We bless you, Father, for this time of Lent, for revealing us the fatherhood, because also life is this. Life is this journey. Lent is this journey from fatherless to fatherhood. It's amazing that Lent starts with the temptation of the devil. If God is your father, why you suffer? If God is your father, why your father abandoned you? If God is your father, and Jesus Christ has to fight this temptation, because the devil wants to put a question mark. So Lent starts with this question mark on the fatherhood of God, and is completed with Easter, the victory of Christ that reveals us God that is Father. What father will sacrifice his son? Now, this is God, like Abraham that sacrificed Isaac, but that is another chapter. We bless you, Father, for revealing us little by little your love for us. We ask you tonight, help us to enter also in this Holy Week, searching for you, searching for your face. Give us also the grace to reconcile with our history, with our Father. And we ask this in the word that your Son has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. The Lord be with you. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Good night.